I don't remember really going on with the history, but I'm going to make a big jump since we're talking about lamination. I kept doing lamination, but also began to incorporate other things. So in the 60s, it had been pretty much 100% lamination. In the 70s, it was, you know, a high percent of lamination, but other sort of ideas began to creep in. Some having more to do with furniture making. But that process really is, if I ever sort of thought clearly, I think that's where I thought most clearly. And it's my vocabulary that I always assumed that lots of people would work this way. And, you know, a few did, quite a few in the 60s, but hardly anybody ever stayed with it. So it never became like a popular process for other people to use. And sometime in the 90s, after having done a lot of kind of different things, the thought kind of came to me about what would I do in my studio if I had no assistants and I had to do everything. If I was had to be totally involved, I'd want to do what I was most comfortable with. So I thought the right thing for me to do would be the laminating and carving, organic kind of pieces of furniture. And I think it's more uniquely me than anything else I've done. The process from the development of the late 60s really didn't change until in the last year. And the last year there's been some dramatic changes, although I hope that anyone that sees the work would never see this, except that they might suspect, because the pieces have become more complex, that we're using digital processes now. For example, we could digitize a piece, a finished piece, and it would then, the program could then slice it for us and give us very accurate patterns should we want to build it again. But now I'm taking it a few steps further, that I'm doing a lot of the design work in model form after drawing it and trying to understand it as best you can. And I think there's two things to make some adjustments on. The first, and what I realized is central, needs to have be a little chubbier. The shape is good. This would be very hard to plan cross sections through. For me to imagine in my mind with great accuracy, let's say, a slice right through here, going through here, through all of those, and around there. You couldn't possibly do that with any accuracy at all. And even though you think that you're not designing with your abilities very much in mind, you are. You really, something just keeps you from designing things that you could not possibly make, or you couldn't possibly make in any reasonable way. And you can kind of throw that out the window now. Now the next step to be taken, and we've already experimented with this, is then have a program which we could build a tool path for and then carve with a machining robot, actually carve the piece. Now, some people think that's a bad thing to do, that it takes away the hand. I'm sure that if I put two side by side, it would be impossible to tell the difference from the totally handmade one or the computer-driven one. There would be no way to tell. I mean, I think you have to do what there is available, you know. You got to keep up with the times. This is the way to go. Particularly for me, you know, at my age, I can't expect that I'm going to have the energy and the strength and the stamina to carve the way I could when I was 30. I'm probably not going to push the rasp as hard or hit the chisel as hard or carve with a chainsaw for as much time per day. But this will make up for all of that. If I've seen this in the 60s, I've been pretty amazed. Because, you know, if we looked at these pieces and you know, I felt that I was pretty accomplished in being able to imagine the cross-section through the pieces I did in the 60s.